one particular verse, and it's difficult to get one verse, but certainly a verse that has an extraordinary amount of relevance to the time and climate in which we presently live. It is Philippians chapter 1, verse 9. I wish every Christian would highlight Philippians chapter 1, verse 9 in their Bible, be it in English, Afrikaans, or otherwise. And this I pray, that your love may abound more and more in all knowledge and real discernment. That your love may abound. That word in Greek, love, is divine love, unconditional love, agape. For God's love, for the love of Jesus, for what God calls love, it is love, God defines love. For it to abound requires knowledge of Scripture and discernment. If there's an absence of the knowledge of the Scripture doctrine, and an absence of discernment, love is not going to abound. What's going to abound is a stupid, emotionally charged religiosity that is love. What's going to abound without doctrinal knowledge and discernment is the emotionally charged religiosity that should have no place in the church other than the dustbin. It goes something like this. Oh, we just have to love. As if love and truth are mutually exclusive. God says love and truth are mutually dependent. A rather nefarious character is Dr. Feelgood. Dr. Feelgood went around in an agricultural community with a tremendous compassion for people who were sick and injured. Everyone said Dr. Feelgood is really wonderful. The problem is Dr. Feelgood knew nothing about pharmacology, knew nothing about physiology, knew nothing about microbiology. Dr. Feelgood was a quack, didn't know what he or she were doing. But some people said, oh, but they're so loving and caring. They were doing things that were getting people killed because they didn't know what they were doing. People just looked upon their so-called sense of compassion. Now, we certainly want healthcare providers to be compassionate people, but we also want them to know what they're doing. Being nice and being compassionate doesn't make you a good physician. In fact, if you go around being nice and compassionate and you don't know what you're doing, you're a bad one. Your love means nothing because it's not real love. You wouldn't be mutilating people. You wouldn't be prescribing the wrong kinds of drugs or giving the wrong kind of diagnosis because you don't know what you're doing. We live in an age where the pulpits of many churches are saturated with Dr. Feelgoods. And when you point this out, the response is stereotypically the same. You're judging, you're being critical, you're unloving. As if love and truth and love and discernment are mutually exclusive. When God says they are mutually dependent, God says they are mutually dependent. The rest is rubbish. The rest is rubbish. You wouldn't want Dr. Feelgood going near your sick child? Well, God doesn't want Dr. Feelgood standing in a pulpit. Let's begin. Talking tonight about the subject of the holy kiss. Look with me, please, to 2 Corinthians chapter 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12. Greet one another with a holy kiss. Well, it's St. Valentine's Day. Before I left home in England to South Africa, I made sure the Valentine was delivered, otherwise there'd be no point in me going home. It is Valentine's Day. You cannot kiss your wife or your husband with one lip. If you're going to kiss your wife or your husband, you must kiss them with two lips. It's anatomically impossible to kiss with a single lip. This in view, Look with me, please, to the 85th Psalm, verse 10. I'm going to translate it from Hebrew. Loving kindness and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Hesed mishamayim nishkaf. Amet min haaretz tizmok. Chesed v'amet nishkachu. A little bit different than the original. It says, chesed, grace, grace from above. Grace that comes from above has met with the truth that belies it. It's when the two come together that you will have the kiss. You cannot communicate the love of the Lord without grace and without truth. You can speak the truth, Paul says in 1 Corinthians, but not speak it in love. You can speak the truth, but not speak it in love. It may be a valid fact, but if it's not spoken in love, it will not achieve anything honoring to the Lord or beneficial to the person. On the other hand, if it is not undergirded by truth, it's worthless. It's nonsense. The two must meet. Grace and truth must meet to communicate the holy kiss. You need two lips in order to kiss. You can kiss with one lip. And the term there is chesed, chesed. Some translations don't exactly get it right. They call it loving kindness. It is chesed. Chesed, like Bethesda, Bethesda. God's covenant mercy. God's covenant mercy is something that he does. It's grace. In Greek the word grace is charism. It means a gift. Something unmerited. Okay? Unmerited. In Hebrew, it's something unmerited. It's just God's mercy. That's all. Unfortunately, in the age in which we live, there's one example where there's no holy kiss, is the ecumenical movement. My family is a mixture of Roman Catholic and Jewish. My family is a mixture of Roman Catholic and Jewish. In Roman Catholicism, grace is an ethereal substance earned by sacraments. It's earned by an ex opere operato ritual. It doesn't come from God, it comes from clergy, the church, the ritual itself. They say there's a sanctifying grace, an actual grace. It's something earned. This is nonsense. Now what happens today? It's very complicated. When you have these ecumenical forums between scholars, you'll get some kind of a Protestant, a conservative Protestant, or an evangelical scholar, theologian, will say, we're saved by grace. And a Jesuit or Catholic scholar will say, yes, we're saved by grace. Oh, the Reformation was a mistake. Let's shake hands and forget the whole thing. Well, they can both agree they're saved by grace, but they have two entirely different definitions of the word grace. They mean two different things by the same word. Everybody understand? This is what happens. It becomes a scam. It becomes a deception. That your love may abound in all knowledge and discernment. There's a lack of discernment. So you buy into a scam. It's not the holy kiss. It becomes the kiss of death. The age in which we live, we see a resurrection of Gnosticism, of a subjective pseudo-spiritual claimed kind of revelation. In Roman Catholicism, their Gnosticism is called the sensus plenior in Latin, the sensus plenior, the fuller sense. So for instance, in the Magnificat, Mary says, when she's told she's going to be the mother of the Messiah, who would save his people from their sin, Gabriel tells her this, the first words out of her mouth. My soul rejoices in God my Savior. Your baby is going to save his people from their sin. Her immediate response, I need a Savior. Oh no. The Pope heads the magisterium of the church. He's the heir of Peter. He has the census plenia. Mary doesn't need a Savior. Wait, but all have sinned. All fall short of the glory of God. Oh, that doesn't include Mary. There's a post. You understand how it works? Whenever you deal with prospects, they will use scriptural terms that mean something different by the terms. The avalanche of Gnostic thinking in the modern world is in a New Age movement, comes from Eastern religion. In Hawaii, there's a mecca for hippies at the foot of the volcano, and they run around naked, smoking cannabis and chanting at the sun. It's crazy what they do. And when you witness to them, you give them gospel tracts and you try to talk to them. You tell them, I saw the light, they will tell you, oh, I saw the light. To them, the light is the cosmic illumination of the inner self. You're thinking of John chapter 1, Jesus the true light. They're thinking of the cosmic illumination of the inner self. You tell them, I believe in sin. Oh, they believe in sin. That's giving place to negative energy. You tell them you believe in the spirit. Oh, they believe in the spirit. To them, it's the zeitgeist, the spirit of the age. You tell them you were born again. Well, they were born again. They're thinking in terms of reincarnation. They will use the same terms you use, but they will mean something entirely different by those terms. When you get into churches who are caught up in things like dominion theology, triumphalism, when they use terms like victory and kingdom, they mean something different by those terms than the scripture does. Even though they profess to be saved Christians, when they're talking kingdom, dominion, kingdom theology, they mean something entirely different by those terms than the Word of God does. We're talking about love. There's no discernment. It's not undergirded by truth. It's not the kiss that is holy. It is the kiss of death. A holy kiss requires grace and truth. If I didn't love people, I wouldn't care what people think. Why should I? Jesus never compromised truth in the name of love. He said things that could be quite pointed, even difficult to understand. When he spoke to the Syrophoenician woman whose daughter was demon-possessed, he used the diminutive of the word dog, which was a derogatory Jewish term for pagans at the time. Puppies, in the Greek, sort of being translated. He said, I can't give children's bread to the dogs. It sounded like he was calling this little girl a dog, or at least a puppy. What was he saying? It sounded almost bigoted. I assure you, we can be assured, Jesus loved that little Gentile girl as much as he would have loved the little Jewish girl. But he made her mother deal with the issue. Your religion is unfit for human consumption. It's fit for dogs. It's not fit for people made in God's image and likeness. You want me to help your daughter? I can do it. But first, you have to come to the realization of the truth about God. And it's not what you believe. Your beliefs are for dogs. Pay attention. The teachings of the Jehovah's Witness, that's dog food. The teachings of Mormonism, that's dog food. The false gospel of the Roman Church that says we're saved by sacraments and that you have to atone in purgatory for your own sin instead of the blood of Christ cleansing from all sin, that's dog food. That Mohammed, according to their own hadith, a pedophile who married Aisha when she was 6 and took her virginity when she was 9, is a greater prophet than Jesus, that's dog food. These things are unfit for human consumption. Jesus never compromised truth in the name of love. Was the woman at the well, the Samaritans had so much in common with the Jews. They believed in God and Moses, at least the 5 books of Moses they believed. They believed in the patriarchs and that the Messiah was coming. But where was sin atoned for? On Mount Zion or Mount Gerizim? As soon as she began with her false doctrine. You Jews have that mountain, we have this mountain in John 4. Before he went any further in the conversation, he said, lady, you don't know what you're talking about. Salvation comes from the Jews. Jesus never, never once compromised truth in the name of love. On the contrary, because he loved, he told people the truth. He endeavored to tell them the truth in love, but he told them the truth. And when he dealt with false religious leaders who were misleading the people, although he could be quite gracious with the Samaritan woman at the well, when it came to dealing with the Sanhedrin who were misleading the people, he was, I wouldn't say less gracious, but certainly he was more indicting in what he told them about what they did. See, this is the point. James 3:1, another verse that you need to highlight. The teachers will be judged more strictly than the rest. And I or David Nathan stand before the Lord, or any other pastors who are here, and we stand before the Lord, that if you will be teachers, teachers will be judged more strictly than the rest. The Lord will hold us more accountable than he holds you. If there's something wrong in my life, that's wrong. That's wrong enough. But if I misuse my position to mislead you into the way of error, that is a whole other level of culpability before God. That's where Jesus could be very, very, very indicting of those who misled the people. There's a lot of people who are being misled today from the pulpit. Jesus said this would happen in the last days. Apostasy would increase, and it certainly has. Even since the last time I've been in Clarkston, new heresies have permeated your community. Even some crazy people from Texas coming over here denying the Trinity. They know how to masquerade it with a holy kiss, except the kiss is not holy. They're all so nice when they go around talking to you and holding their Bibles. But they deny one God in three persons. Grace and truth don't meet each other. When they give you the holy kiss, because the kiss is not holy. They're giving you the kiss of death. Hell no, I said so. It's one God in three persons. But that's another issue. Let's continue. Look with me, please, to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, and piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. In my way of being, before I studied theology, I studied medical science. Today it's done by laser technology, but in those days, when I was a kid, it was done by surgical micrometer. For leukemia patients of a certain kind, you could do erythrocyte transplants, transplant red blood cells from the marrow of large bones like the femur and the tibia. Bone cells, osteocytes, dye stain a kind of yellowish white, or kind of somewhat grayish white. Okay. Marrow dye stains maroon. But when the two kinds of tissues come together, you'll see in the micrometer a rust-colored stripe. Where does the bone end and the marrow begin? It's not so easy to tell without a micrometer. Today, again, the technology is much better because of lasers and things. Not so easy to tell. What the scripture tells us is this: the relationship between the soul, the mind, and the spirit is like that. Where does one end and the other begin? As imago Dei beings, we're made in God's image and likeness. We have a body because God does. Even in the Old Testament, there were Christophanies before the incarnation. When Adam heard God walking in the garden, that was Jesus. When Jacob wrestled with the Metatron, the angel of the Lord, that was Jesus. The Holy Spirit and the Father never become incarnate. It's always the Son. Always the Son. We have a spirit because God does. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit searches the depths of God. We have a mind because God does. Who has known the mind of the Father? This is trinity of the Godhead is a big subject. But there's a problem. What people are psychologically, what the soul is, Adam breathed. God breathed on Adam, and Adam became a living soul. Animals have souls, according to Scripture, but it's purely physiological. Okay, it's purely the byproduct of organic metabolism. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Kol ha-nshamah ten ha-le-liyah. Hallelujah. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. But Adam has a living soul, made in God's image and likeness. When people are psychologically, our awareness, our intellectual consciousness, emotions, is a composite, a hybrid of what we are organically, chemically, and what we are spiritually. Mental illness never originates in the mind, never. When somebody is mentally ill, there's either something wrong with them chemically, hypothyroidism, whatever, or there's something wrong with them spiritually, or both. Clinical psychology is a pseudoscience, it's a fraud. It's not quantitative, it's not even real science. You can talk about moral psychology or biopsychology or psychiatric medicine, but straight psychology isn't even real science. And in fact, what it is the religion of man. It's the deification of the mass religion of secular humanism. That's all it is. However, something happens in secular psychology because it's based on Darwinistic presupposition. We are simply apes with better DNA in their thinking. The spiritual dimension of man, going back to Carl Jung's collective unconscious, is a function of the mind. It doesn't make a distinction. In Eastern religion, the same thing happens. There is this confusion between the spirit and the soul in Eastern religion. But not in scripture, not the scriptural understanding of the anthropology of man as a theopomorphic being. Okay. Well, what happens? There was he's now a criminally convicted swindler, a young child in Korea, and he's sentenced to 3.5 years with his son and a pair of crooks, always having crooks, but people in the West were impressed by the size of his church, not realizing there are far bigger visualization cults in Asia than his, but people in the West got taken in by it. And this guy, Yemi Chow, wrote a book called The Fourth Dimension. And he said your subconscious imagination is your spirit. So you visualize what you want in your imagination, that's your spirit. And then you use the Kenneth Hagin, Kenneth Copeland word faith formula, name it and claim it, and you confess it into being. I want a red bicycle. I want a husband who's an Afrikaans. I want a visualize. I'm serious. And he writes in his book, he writes this, that Hindus and Buddhists have known this for centuries. Now Jesus Christ has shown it to him. I know he's a convicted swindler. Whether or not he's a Christian, I don't know. But I know that he's a Buddhist. He teaches mystical Buddhism. He teaches Oriental shamanism. He teaches Hinduism. He confuses the two. Among my fellow charismatics and Pentecostals, this problem is prolific. There are things that are their own mind that they think is the spirit, but it is not. It's what Jeremiah said, the futility and deception of their own mind when they prophesy. They think it's prophecy, but it's not prophecy, it's clairvoyance. I do not deny a scriptural gift of tongues, but most of what you hear today is not authentic, it's gibberish. Some Mormons do the same thing, some Mormons don't speak in tongues. But they think it is, going by their feelings, thinking that's the spirit. We are told in scripture twice, the fruit of the spirit is ikete, self-control. I saw people coming back and in Toronto, Canada some years ago, and it was absurd what they were doing. They were shaking like this, saying, I know it was God, I couldn't control it. Well, if the fruit of the Spirit is self-control, that proves prima facie it couldn't be God. It couldn't be God. When you see them manifesting in things like this, what this stuff is a combination of hypnotic induction combined with demonic deception. It is a combination of hypnotic induction combined with demonic deception. But they've been taught by ignorant clergy that it's the Spirit. And it's the Spirit. A very dangerous man from your country was Rodney Howard Brown. He doesn't like me. And it was unbelievable what he was getting away with. He stood up in front of 7,000 people in Melbourne, Australia, and said I was destroying or trying to destroy his ministry or something. He was right. And I knew people in Pietermaritzburg, people who are related to him, who come to my meetings who like me, and they told me he was weird even when he was a kid. But anyway, it was unbelievable what he did. He changed one word in one verse and gave a completely different meaning. 1 Corinthians 2:15. That your love may abound more and more in all knowledge and real discernment. And when him and Kenneth Copeland and Mike Evans were clowning in tongues, he said, don't try to understand this, don't try to judge this. The natural mind does not understand the things of the Spirit. The verse says, the natural man does not understand the things of the Spirit. Unsaved people do not understand the things of the Spirit of God. That is true. That's what the verse says. He changes man to mind, and that means suspend critical faculties. Don't judge something on the basis of Scripture. Don't try to discern the difference between what is carnal, what is fleshly, and what is genuinely of the Lord. This is a dangerous man. I heard John Arnott saying the same things. Don't try to test it or understand it, just dive in. Are you going to dive into a dam without knowing the depth of it if you haven't been there before? You know if there's alligators or crocodiles or whatever you gotta be in a crocodile. It's dangerous, isn't it? Dangerous. Just dive in. Suspend critical faculty. And the people in these churches are told that if you do judge it on the basis of Scripture, you are suppressing the Spirit. One proven false prophet in America, named Mike Bickle, teaches young people. I know a lot of this is not of the Lord, it's of the flesh, he says. But I'd rather we have to let what is of the flesh take place so we won't suppress the Spirit. Now the Scripture says, crucify the flesh, so what is of the Spirit will blossom. God says, crucify what's of the flesh, so what is of the Spirit will blossom. He's not just with it. These are dangerous people. They are very dangerous people. Their influence is prolific, especially among young people. It's a two-edged sword, sharper than a two-edged sword. It's how the Word of God works. The first and foremost test, is that a real prophecy? Is that a real word of knowledge? Is what that person is saying, is it true? Is it from the Lord? Is this manifestation really the Holy Spirit? The first and foremost test is always the Word of God. Amen. Always. Now it's sharper. False religions and cults always have a counterfeit. Jesus is the Logos. He's the Word made flesh. Jesus can be understood as the Scripture incarnate. The Scripture can be understood as Jesus in print. If that makes sense, it's in Greek. But Jesus is the Logos. The word Antichrist in Greek means not only against Christ, but in place of Christ, Antichrist. There is another word for Antichrist most Christians are not familiar with, but it is found in Scripture. Again, same word, but different case of me. Pseudo logos. Jesus is the logos, but there is a false word of God, a pseudo logos. Every false religion and cult, including those that come in the name of Christianity or Judeo-Christian belief, have one. The Quran is a pseudo logos. The Book of Mormon is a pseudo logos. The Talmud of unbelieving Jews who reject their Messiah is a pseudo logos. Okay? Pseudo logos. The Watchtower is a pseudo logos. Papal encyclical, pseudo logos. They all have a false word of God. And it is sharp. Jesus uses sexual seduction to illustrate the way spiritual seduction works. He draws on the imagery of the Old Testament, as does the Apostle James, particularly the prophets Amos, Jeremiah, but above all, Hosea, where idolatry was called adultery. Israel was to be God's woman. Daughter of Zion, who played the harlot, things like this, okay? The seducing things like this, okay? The Apostle James, again, employs this in James chapter 4. He speaks to worldly churches, and he calls worldly churches, you adulteresses, drawing on this Old Testament motif of infidelity, snoot, harlotry, you translate it basically, snoot. Well, Jesus tells the church of Thyatira, you tolerate the woman Jezebel, who beguiles, who seduces my servants. False religion seduces the people of God. The Scripture uses sexual seduction to illustrate spiritual seduction. We see this most graphically, of course, in Revelation chapters 17 and 18 in the New Testament, but it's something that comes from the Old. Look with me, please, to understand this in the book of Proverbs. We'll begin in chapter 5. Verse 1, my son, give attention to my wisdom. Incline your ear to my understanding, that you may observe discretion, and your lips may reserve knowledge. For the lips of an adulteress drip honey. Smoother than oil is her speech. Spiritual seduction, again, the holy kiss. Only it's not holy, it's the kiss of death, but it drips honey, it's sweet. False religion knows how to entice. The kiss seems sweet. You can put a few drops of arsenic in the honey, but you won't know it's toxic. It seems sweet. Let's look at it. Without knowledge, you're going to kiss her. But in the end, she's as bitter as one word. Sharp as a two-edged sword. False religion, what they teach, what they say, it's sharp as a two-edged sword. The Watchtower seems to make sense to people who've never been exposed to right doctrine. Roman Catholicism can appeal to people. Islam can appeal to people. People get taken in by these things. The teachings of the con artists, word faith, money preachers like Ray McCauley, these guys, you've got your version, but they come from America as well. It seems to appeal, they want to have their ears tickled. It seems right, people get taken in by these con artists. Drips honey, it sounds sweet. It's sharp as a two-edged sword. Therefore, in order not to be seduced, You need something living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword. You need a better instrument, something that is sharper. All of these things are sharp. The Quran, the Watchtower, the Book of Mormon, they're sharp. People buy into them. Don't these Texans run around denying the Trinity? They speak real nice and they seem so loving and their lips drip on it. They seem to have a kind of anointing. Look what it says. It's rather frightening. It's smoother than oil. It's not a real anointing. The word oil, mishkan in Hebrew, comes from the word same as Messiah, anointing. They have an anointing and it's smooth. It's smooth. It's smoother than the real one. It's not truer than the real one, but it's smoother. Let's look. She doesn't ponder the path of life. Why is she unstable? She doesn't even know it. The people caught up in these things don't even know it's false. They believe it's true. Now then, my sons, listen to me. Do not depart from the words of my mouth. Keep your way far from her. Don't go near to the door of her house. Keep away from those churches. For you'll give your vigor to others and your ears to the cool one. Strangers will be filled with your strength. What happened to Samson? Let's continue. Now it compares her to the true bride, you know. A loving, kind, graceful doe is your wife. Let her breast satisfy you at all times. Again, this is speaking metaphorically. You build up the word, things like that. But let's look at chapter 6. Don't go near her. Don't go near her. Keep away from her. We are told in verse 24. Commandment is the lamp and the teaching light, the roots of correction on the way of life, to keep you from the evil woman, from the smooth tongue of the adulteress, verse 24. Don't desire her beauty in your heart. Oh, it looks good. These churches, these cults, they seem attractive. Nor let her capture you with her eyes, for on account of a harlot, one is reduced to a loaf of bread. An adulteress hunts for the precious life. Can a man take fire in his bosom and his clothes not be burned? It goes on. Let's look at chapter 7. Verse 5. That they may keep you from an adulteress, from the foreigner who flatters with her words. For at the window of my house I looked out through the lattice. I saw among the naive and discerned among the youths a young man lacking sense. Passing through the street, near her corner, he takes the way to her house. In the evening, in the twilight, in the middle of the night, in the darkness, behold, a woman comes to meet him, dressed as a harlot and cunning of heart. She's boisterous and rebellious. Her feet do not remain at home. She's now in the streets, now in the squares, and lurks by every corner. She seizes him and kisses him, and with a brazen face says to him, I was due to offer my peace offerings today. I paid my vows. Therefore, I've come out to meet you, to seek your presence earnestly, and I found you. Just like a whore in Durban looking for a drunken sailor. She doesn't really like him, but she's got her own agenda. He's just a bill of goods. I'd spread my couch with coverings and colored linens of Egypt, the world. I'd sprinkle my bed with myrrh, anointed for burial, of course, aloes and cinnamon. Let us drink our fill of love until morning. Let us delight ourselves with caresses. Now look at verse 19. My husband's not at home. He's gone on a journey. Don't worry about Jesus coming back. Don't worry about the bridegroom coming. Don't worry about Jesus coming. The Harvard Church doesn't care about Jesus coming back. That's why you have people like Rick Warren saying, avoid end time prophecy, it's a diversion. Jesus twice reiterates it. Be alert, watch for these signs. No, Rick Warren says keep away from it. It's the whole thing. He's gone on a journey. He's not coming. But don't think about the last days. Don't think about prophecy. Don't think that current events in the Middle East fulfill prophecy. Don't think of these things. He's gone on a journey. He's not coming back. And she aims for the youth. The youth always get caught in it. Take my word for nothing. Please don't believe me. Go watch this for yourself on YouTube. The scandal in America. Hillsong from Australia came. They had their women's conference. Now in Australia, Australian Broadcasting first exposed the big financial scandals at Hillsong. Then there was the sexual scandals. Again, this is on television, it's not gossip. And it's all true. Frank Houston, the patriarch of Hillsong, the homosexual pedophile, I knew preachers who knew that about him 40 years ago but couldn't prove it. Now his son, Brian Houston, is in trouble with the police for protecting his father. Then there was Pat Mesiti, the second in command of Hillsong. At least he liked girls instead of little boys. And then there was Bobby Houston, her series, Christian Women Love Sex. That was the series. Now when you read the Song of Solomon and what the Song of Solomon says about marital romance, appropriately today being Valentine's Day and so forth, of course, there's a lot of typology in the Song of Solomon. It uses Hebrew poetry to convey things about God's relationship with Israel and Christ's relationship with the church. It's a metaphor, but it speaks of marital intimacy and romance. And it's always, Anita do diva do dili. I am my beloved is mine. It's always about the relationship. Sexuality becomes the vehicle, not the aim. Christian women love sex. No, Christian women love the Lord. Christian women love their husbands and their families. They love babies. How do we get one? It's always the person, the relationship is the focus in marital romance when you look at scripture. Although it's highly erotic as literature, it's erotic poetry. It certainly is. The focus is on the relationship, the person, not the act. The world, Hollywood, whatever, takes the focus off the relationship, off the person, and puts it on the act. So does Hillsong. Now you've got teenage girls and early adolescents, 13, 14, 15, and they're all obsessed with Bobby Houston, Christian Women Love Sex, and they're all... It's the world. That's what they teach the youth. So they come to their Hillsong Women's Conference in New York. Bobby Houston was the speaker, the keynote speaker, and the pastor in New York. Unbelievable. He went on television on Larry King led Oprah Winfrey and refused to say homosexuality was a sin. First they have Jesus coming out in female drag, dressed as a woman, as Lady Liberty, as the Statue of Liberty. And instead of the crown of thorns, they have the crown of the Statue of Liberty. And he comes down like this, dressed as a woman, as a Lady Liberty. And they begin singing the Frank Sinatra song, New York, New York, to Jesus. Watch this on YouTube. Don't take my word for it. And then they bring out, this is an extravaganza now. It was obviously something that was choreographed with pyrotechnics, with fireworks, with chorus girls. It was choreographed. The naked cowboy. The youth minister standing there with cowboy boots, a cowboy hat standing on the back of a guitar, and these cheerleaders jumping around in it. And they call this worship. They call this worship. And there was a couple of thousands of Christian women, young women, some of them married even, and they're all clapping and cheering. This is, they think it's worship. How sick and deranged can you possibly get? Don't take my word for it. Go watch this yourself. It gets worse and worse. You take it in mind. It seduces, and it particularly seduces the young. They aim for young. Whoever is naive and discerning, She's out there like a whore looking for a score. That's all it is. A harlot church. We have to sharpen. Subjective. This is what it means to me. The sharper sword is always objective. This is what it means, full stop. The Lord may quicken some passage or story or narrative to your own situation and speak to you through it by the Holy Spirit when you seek Him in prayer for guidance in circumstances of life or something like that. That is true. But if He does that, it will always be predicated upon the objective doctrinal meaning. Sometimes very sincere and well-intentioned believers get caught up in this, not realizing it. Here's how it happens, very often, probably most often. In South Africa, as in many countries, it's getting more and more difficult for Christians to find biblically based churches that are Christ-centered. So more and more of them are meeting in homes and small groups with other like-minded people. That's a good thing in itself, if they can't find a good church. But what can happen is they forget there's a biblical gift of teaching. And they sit around and they pray and they fellowship and all that, maybe even invite unsaved people over to hear the gospel. Well, that's good. But I've seen this. They read and discuss a passage of scripture. And they go around in a circle. This is what it means to me. This is what it means to me. Everybody ascribes their own meaning. There's an objective meaning. What's the objective meaning? Before you ask what it means for you or for me, what does it mean? We'll stop. What does it mean for all of us? This is a problem. That which is sharp has a subjective meaning. That which is sharper has an objective meaning. Let's continue. That which is sharp truth is relational. That which is sharper truth is there's a very dangerous deceiver in America, and his son is worse, named Tony Campolo. He's a sociologist. He's not a Christian. Not a Christian preacher. He's a Christian sociologist. And he comes to Britain, he speaks on the BBC, and he says crazy things. Like, God loved King David because of his gusto. Even when he sinned, he did it with gusto. That's why God loved him. No, read Psalm 51. God loved him because he repented sincerely. And Coppola tells the story why he changed his position on homosexuality. Some woman got his phone number and called him up and asked him if it was a sin, and he said, yeah, and it was wrong, and she said, yes. And she begins crying, and he says, why are you calling me up and asking me this? And she said, because my son was a homosexual and he killed himself 3 weeks ago. And he was such a good boy. So he changes his position, not based on what Romans says, or what the Torah says about homosexuality, not what God says. Truth becomes relational. Truth becomes relational. Again, love depends on knowledge and discernment. You think of the old Irish lady, or Polish, or Italian, or Hispanic, or French lady, on her deathbed, who was a Roman Catholic, clenching rosary beads, afraid to die for fear of going to purgatory, because there's no assurance of salvation in Roman Catholicism. In Roman Catholicism, if you say you have the assurance of salvation, it's called the sin of presumption. Scripture says, the blood of Christ cleanses from all sin, perfect love casts out all fear. Yet in the name of love, we have some sick and perverted evangelical leaders going around saying evangelical Christians should accept Catholicism as valid. How can you let that old lady die in fear instead of telling her the gospel? Knowing that the blood of Christ cleanses her all sin, she thinks she's going to purgatory to burn for the temporary hell. That's not love, that's sick. Find me an ex-Catholic who was not happy that somebody told them the truth. Do you have any ex-Catholics here? Are you happy that you found out the truth?
God is good.
God is good, and Rome is evil. But people say, they'll say, oh, but I met the Pope, he's such a wonderful man. Yet when he was the Cardinal in Buenos Aires, Argentina, he refused to meet with the families of children who were sexually molested by priests. Oh, but I met him, he's so gracious. Somehow, truth becomes relational instead of doctrinal. That was the Tony Bama. Truth is doctrinal. Let's continue. Scriptural truth is mysterious. Mysterious, we have mysteries. Things that are hidden that are revealed in Christ to his people. We have the mystery of the gospel. We have the mystery of Christ and the church in Ephesians 5. We have the mystery of iniquity at the end of the age concerning the Antichrist. There are mysteries. Our faith is mysterious. It is not mystical. There is a pseudo-spirituality prevalent among my fellow charismatics and Pentecostals, and it's mysticism. They are calling entertainment worship. Hillsong's not worship, it's entertainment. Jesus and drag, singing New York, New York to him, and it frantic. This is entertainment, this is not worship. It's not hype, they say. They say it's anointing. No, it's not anointing, it's hype. They are calling hype anointing, they are calling entertainment worship, and they are calling mysticism spirituality. Our faith theological. It is not philosophical. Paul warns the church in Colossae about the vain philosophies of the world. Now there is biblical philosophy. The vine philosophy is the book of Ecclesiastes, Kohelet in Hebrew. The British had Hobbes and Beetham, and the Germans, you know, they had Nietzsche and Hegel, and the Greeks had Aristotle, and they, you know, and Plato. Everybody has their own philosophers. Well, God's philosophy is the book of Ecclesiastes. But it's theologically based, and it's not philosophically based. That which is sharp is philosophical. Today, the church is being run on the philosophies of man. I'll give you one or two examples. The marketing philosophy of an unsaved, now deceased marketing guru, Peter Drucker. Rick Warren admits he got the purpose-driven agenda from Peter Drucker. You find out what kind of a church people wanted. You do your market research, find out what kind of a church they want, and give it to them. God does not give people what kind of a church they want. He gives them a kind of church that he says they need. Philosophy of the world today is consumerism. Consumerism of the Western, certainly the developed world. Consumerism. In the United States, I don't know if you have it in South Africa, you certainly have it in America, and to a degree in Europe and Asia, certainly in Asia and America. There are no programming on the TV channels. It's just one commercial after another. Call 1-800-JUNK now. This piece of junk can also be yours. Just give us your Visa number. This becomes name it and claim it, blab it and grab it. It's consumerist philosophy getting into the church. The whole church growth movement is based on this stuff. It began with Robert Schuller, the Crystal Cathedral. Well, before he died, he lost his Crystal Cathedral. He went and bet $56 million, and he lost all the whole thing. It crashed down. Unless the Lord builds a house, it cannot stand. Not even the Crystal Cathedral. The laborers labor in vain. Oh, you can build a mega church on the philosophies of man, but it can't stand. It can't stand. Let's continue. That which is sharper. Is exigent. It is not asegetical. In other words, this relates to the inductive and the deductive. You can only base doctrine by taking out of God's word what's in there, exegetically, rightly dividing the word of God, exegesis. You can't base doctrine on reading something into it that it doesn't state. Now you can have the opinion, a deductive opinion, it seems to me, but you can't base a doctrine on it. Let me give you a couple of examples. Here in South Africa, you have the problem of the Dutch Reformed Church. Sprinkling babies, telling people they're Christians when they're not. We once had a dormant, he gets saved in the cave when he was a Christian because he was sprinkled as a baby. He was a dormant. Well, there are two kinds of passages in Scripture. Those that clearly support believers' baptism, and those that are ambiguous. We interpret the ambiguous passages in light of the clear ones. At a criminal trial, you have a guilty client and a crooked lawyer. What the crooked lawyer is going to do is amplify the circumstantial evidence out of proportion. It, like that guy, that handicapped athlete they had down here, both killed the chick. They're gonna, if the story is, all the world I want to know is, believe it. You amplify the circumstantial evidence out of all proportion to the facts in order to artificially put a doubt in the mind of the jury. Well, they do the same thing. You shall be saved, you and your household. Well, that means the babies. That must have meant the babies too, so they sprinkle. They're reading into the text something it doesn't say. Instead of interpreting the ambiguous passages in light of the clear ones, they amplify the ambiguous ones out of proportion to bring a nebulous lens to look at what's plainly stated. Okay. It seems to me, this is my opinion, the battle of Gog and Magog from Ezekiel 38 and 39. We interpret the Old Testament in light of the New Testament revelation of Jesus. Therefore, there's a battle of Gog and Magog at the end of the millennial reign of Christ. That must be the main one, because that's the one the New Testament states. However, it seems to me, by way of deduction, that there may be two of them, two battles of Gog and Magog. Because there are things like, if it's the end of the time as we've known it, how are they cleaning up the battlefield for 7 months and things like that? It seems to me that there may be two battles of Gog and Magog, that the stage may be being set for one now, and the one that happens now, or in the near future, or whatever, somehow prefigures or foreshadows this final ultimate one. It seems to me there could be two. That's my opinion. But I can't be dogmatic about it. And I can't say that if you don't agree with me, you're a heretic. Maybe I'm right, maybe I'm not. I think I'm right, but maybe I'm not. But I can't make a doctrine out of it. Once I teach it as a doctrine, however, now I'm accountable to the Lord. You can qualify it. You can only base doctrine on what is exegetically determined, not asegetically. Now again, it's not a subject I'm here to address, but the modern academic patriarch of pre-tribulationism, Dr. John Wolfert, wrote the book that most pre-tribulational theologians follow. And in his book on the rapture, he admitted there is no single passage of scripture, none, that specifically teach a pre-tribulational rapture. It's an opinion we glean from an overview. He admits it's not exegetically stated. It's not inductively stated. It's an opinion. But there are people who make it a fundamental, almost. Now, you can be pre-trib. I have many friends who are. And I don't fight about it. We discuss it. At least, well, some of them want to fight about it. But okay, that's right. But you can't be dogmatic about something not plainly stated. If you're right, maybe you're wrong. Maybe I agree, maybe I don't. But to be dogmatic? No, that which is sharper is exegetical and inductive. Let's continue. That which is sharper is apostolic. That which is sharper is apostolic. That which is sharp is patristic. What do I mean? Christian doctrine in the New Testament was authored by the apostles, personally trained by Jesus and inspired by the Holy Spirit. The only basis for Christian doctrine is what the apostles wrote. It's apostolic. Mainstream Protestantism, Roman Catholicism, and Eastern Orthodoxy, all three of them, including many professed evangelical churches and denominations, based doctrine on the patristic, the church fathers. In Calvin's Institutes, he would write repeatedly, by the authority of Augustine, by the authority of Augustine had no authority. Augustine said, because God used violence to convert St. Paul when he knocked him off the horse, the church can use violence to convert people. What a Pandora's box that opened. When Constantine pseudo-Christianized the Roman Empire, they had a problem. They had to spiritualize away the millennial reign of Christ. The early church were all pre-millennial. Now they had to get rid of it because the millennium has come. It's realized in the church. What does Augustine do? Well, he pulled the Rodney Howard Brown before Rodney Howard Brown pulled it. That's what he did. The parable of the wheat and tares. If you read the parable of the wheat and tares, Jesus says, let the two grow together to the end of the age. The field is the world. Augustine changes one word in one verse. The field is the church. The church is made up of the saved and the unsaved. Therefore, sprinkle the babies. Every citizen of the Roman Empire should be considered a Christian instrument. That's what you had here with the Dutch Reformed Church, the Catholic Church. They all did it. And it goes back to Augie. Augustine did not place the emphasis on the original Greek and Hebrew. His Bible of choice is the Latin Vulgate, the Roman Catholic Bible. That's where Calvin got his doctrine. Augustine is the patriarch of both Reformed Protestantism and Roman Catholicism. That's it. But it's sharp. I'm not saying Augustine didn't say some true things. Every teacher of error says true things. When the Jehovah's Witnesses knock on the door, you and I will agree with 50% of what they say. That's what Peter says. They parasozousin. They put truth next to error. They use things that are true to camouflage things that are false. That's how it works. That which is sharper is always correct. That which is sharp is always politically correct. And long for the days when PC meant personal computer. Sake of being politically correct, are going to conform to the demands and standards of the world at the expense of God's truth. And today, same-sex marriage is a major issue. Look out. Look out. Let's continue. That which is sharper is intellectually defensible. There's an apologia for it. That which is sharp is either intellectual, or it is purely intellectual. Come, let us reason together, says the Lord. Paul says our faith is reasonable. It's not reasonable to be a Muslim. It's not reasonable to believe that a pedophile is the greatest prophet greater than Jesus Christ. It's not reasonable to believe in the Quran that the sun gets tired at the end of the day and sinks into a miry pit and then resurrects the next day and that accounts the sun rising. It's not reasonable to believe such a book. It's not reasonable. It's not reasonable to believe the Book of Mormon. It's not reasonable. Or the teachings of Mormonism. Journal of Discourses of Brigham Young, Volume 17, is Quakers Living on the Moon. It's not reasonable to believe such things. But there are empirical, the claims of Jesus, the historicity of the Gospels, the proof of his resurrection, there's empirical evidence for it. There's intellectually credible reason to believe the Gospel. It is not a blind faith. There are plausible reasons. With over 500 Jewish people in different places at different times, in different countries, be willing to be martyred and even see their families killed, testifying with their dying breath they saw him alive after he was crucified, if they didn't. There's reasons to believe it. Be careful of those who have either an intellectual faith or an anti-intellectual faith. The intellectual ones, it's purely intellectual. It's a head knowledge, but not a heart knowledge. If somebody has a heart knowledge, God will give them the head knowledge. If somebody's heart is right, they will want to understand. Look at Acts chapter 4, verse 13. Perceiving them, the apostles, to be uneducated men, they were confounded by their wisdom because they realized they had been with Jesus. It is impossible to walk with Jesus and not get smarter. You hear what I said? It's impossible to walk with Jesus and not get smarter. When you see people who are Christian yokels, there's something wrong with it. Our faith is not intellectual, but it's intellectually credible. Neither is our faith anti-intellectual. Be careful of people like this. They say, you have a head knowledge. You're just like a Pharisee. Jesus said, woe to you scribes and Pharisees. Yes, he did. Their problem was spiritual pride, not knowledge or education. Jesus said, I will send you. I will send you prophets and scribes. The Sophim, theological experts of the day. Ezra was a scribe. I'll send you scribes. Jesus said, when a scribe becomes a disciple, he brings out of the treasury things old and things new. I will send you scholars. I will send you theologians. I will send you people who know the biblical languages. Thank God for people like John Wycliffe and William Tyndale who knew the biblical languages. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to read it in English. Quite a thing. Jesus was never anti-intellectual. Be careful. When you see people who have an intellectual faith, they have a problem with spiritual pride based on superiority. When you see people who have an anti-intellectual faith, they have a problem with spiritual pride based on inferiority. If somebody has an intellectual faith, it's spiritual, it reveals spiritual pride based on superiority. If somebody has an anti-intellectual faith, it is spiritual pride based on inferiority. You don't need that Bible knowledge, boy. You just need Jesus. Look at Peter's epistle when he concludes. He says the scriptures that are difficult to understand, which the untaught and unstable distort to their own destruction. But Paul is a rabbi from the school of Hillel. Let Paul explain these complicated things according to the grace given him. I'm a fisherman. Praise God, he uses me anyway, but Paul is a rabbi. He can explain these things. Notice the second generation of leaders in the book of Acts. who God raised up. Barnabas, Paul, Apollos were more educated than the first. They were more educated than the first generation. When you see an anti-intellectualism, it is no more spiritual or Christ-like or of God. Than the Sanhedrin, the people don't know the law. Let's continue. Our faith, which is sharper. Has criticality. That which is false, yet sharp. As passivity. Let's go back for a moment to Hebrews 4:12. Look what it says. The Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. Book of Mormon, a paper encyclical, the Quran, whatever, and piercing as far as the division of both soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Able to judge. That Greek word is kritikos. Kritikos. To objectively examine something and test it on the basis of scripture, criticos. Yet you have these baboons pretending to be preachers. That when you do what the scripture says, they tell you, you have a critical spirit. Well, I certainly hope so. If you don't have a critical spirit, there's something wrong with you. We are commanded, not encouraged, not admonished. We are commanded to have a critical spirit. Not critical in the sense of fault finding, but critical in the sense of critical thoughts. Cults discourage critical thought, don't they? Just believe what you're told. That's not the Holy Spirit. That's not the spirit of Jesus. That comes from Eastern religion, passivity. That which is sharper is always contextual, which is sharp is always monotextual. One example. Text, context, no text. In John chapter 6, the Catholic Church will always point out the verse, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you cannot have life within you. Transubstantiation. Read the text in context. Keep reading 9 verses further. The flesh profits nothing. The sarx profits nothing. In the context, even the flesh means believing. We have teachings on our website explaining this. The text out of context and isolation from co-text is always a pretext. This is the unmistakable signature of Satan. Let's look at it. The temptation narrative in Matthew 4 or Mark 4. The whole argument between Jesus and Satan is based on Deuteronomy. Satan would say, it is written! Monotextual, one verse. But quoting from Deuteronomy, Jesus says, "For it is also written." Look with me, please, to Psalm 119, verse 160. Very briefly, if you will. "The sum of thy word is truth." Pay attention. Everything in the Word of God is true. Everything in the Word of God is true. But it is the sum of His Word that is truth. It's all true. Everything's true. But it is only the composite of it that is truth. Text out of context, in isolation from context, is always a pretext. It's unbelievable how they get away with this. Three times you have the verse in Samuel, in Chronicles, and in Psalms, always referring to David's encounter in the cave of En-Gedi with King Saul. "Touch not my anointed." Now Saul really was God's anointed. Whether or not Benny Hinn was ever is debatable. But Saul was. No, David would not touch him. But read in context, it did not stop David from telling the truth about him or from prevent Samuel from writing the truth about him under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit directly, or God putting in his word for all eternity that he was a backslider and a murderer. Killed Abiathar the priest, tried to kill David, misled the nation, went into the occult and necromancy. He's an evil man. "Touch not my anointed." When you point out that Rainbow Colby is a conniver, or Theo Vermeer is a conniver, "Touch not my anointed." That's not what "touch not my anointed" means. It's always monotextual. That becomes the get out of jail free card. Look, you're living with your girlfriend and you're not married, and you say you're a Christian. "But he who's without sin cast the first stone." Read John 8. Jesus told the woman what she was doing is wrong and told her to stop doing it. He forgave her, but he told her to stop doing it. Oh, sounds good. "But he is without sin cast the first stone. Touch not my anointed." Unbelievable. But they buy into it. Let us look. God's truth, that which is sharp, is pure. Greek word kathosis, Hebrew tahor. Psalm 51 is usually mistranslated, at least English. I can't say about Afrikaans or Dutch. In Hebrew, it is lev tahor brali Elohim. Not created me a clean heart, that's not it. Created me a pure heart. No mixture. Okay. That which is sharp has a mixture. Well, what's the difference? Again, let's look at a young Christian couple who really are in love. And they get engaged and they're very seriously in love and they want to marry in Christ and they're both Christians. And that's it. It's not anything other than a committed relationship of two believers. But after a candlelight dinner on Valentine's Day, they're walking hand in hand, and they get a bit carried away with their affections. Now, God is very realistic. Paul tells them what to do. I understand testosterone, I understand progesterone, and I understand estrogen. I invented those things, say it that way. They were my idea. I understand how it works. Better to marry than to burn. Move the marriage date forward if that's your problem. I understand the problem. Elope. Send your family a postcard from Mauritius. But they don't do that. They consummate their relationship instead of their marriage.
Well, we really do love each other.
Well, indeed they may. It's not some chickie, some broadie picked up in a shabin or something. They really are in love. It's not just, it's not fornication per se, yet it is. There's a mixture. There's a mixture. You will always find where there's error, a mixture of truth and error. Parasuksusin, putting that which is good next to that which is bad, that which is true next to that which is false. What's sharper is always pure. Tahor, ketasis. Let's continue. That which is sharper is always crystal centric. That which is sharp is non crystal centric. I'll give you an example. The Holy Spirit always points people to Jesus, never himself. Except when he's worshipped in the context of the Trinity. One God in three persons, that's holy, holy, holy. Perfectly biblical. Charles Wesley here. The Holy Spirit is never prayed to outside of the triune of the Godhead. He always points people to Christ, never himself. Do you see people? Good morning, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, let your fire fall. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. None of that is biblical. It opens the door to a counterfeit spirit. That which is sharper is always focused on the person of Christ. Always. No exceptions. That which is sharper is theocentric. That which is sharp is religio-centric. What do I mean? Every cult, every false religion, including those making the bogus claim of being Judeo-Christian, are not really about the worship of God or based on his eternal truth. They are about the worship of the religion, the institution. If you understand Jehovah's Witnesses, it's not about Jehovah, it's about the Watchtower Society. That's their God. If you understand Mormonism,
or the Church of Jesus Christ, Latter-day Saints,
their deity is the institution, it's Mormonism. Fundamentalist Muslims worship Islam. Roman Catholics, if they're really devout Catholics, it's the Holy Mother of the Church. This can take place in denominational Protestantism. They deify the institution. They deify the institution. Or the cult. Like these Texans running around here. These cowboys, man. These guys. It's always about advancing the interest of the ism. They all worship the ism. Orthodox Jews worship Judaism. Not Mosaic Judaism, Talmudic Judaism. They worship Talmudic Judaism. That's their real God. And that is the real purpose of what they teach. That which is sharper is teleocentric. That which is sharp is temporal-centric. What do I mean? Pay attention. Every lie of Satan, virtually, aimed at the church in the Western world today, is temporal-centric. It's designed to get us to trust in this life or this world. What is on back of Kingdom Now theology, Dominionism? Trusting in this world. What is on back of the Platinum Grammar, name it and claim it, word faith? Trusting in this world. What is on back of the purpose-driven lie? Trusting in this world. And it seems to appeal to people, it's sharp. That which is sharper is teleocentric. It's always focused at the end game. What happens when we stand before Christ and receive our reward? Or the climax of the age, the return of Jesus, the blessed hope. That's always the focus. Always. No, Rick Warren says avoid end time prophecy, it's a diversion. You've got people like Gerald Coates in Britain and they're saying that the rapture is a fantasy and a myth, and Mike Bickle saying that the rapture of Elijah was God's judgment on Elijah. Take your focus off the end. Put it on the... What kind of a rugby player would you want something? You got it now. Would you want a coach of the Springboks who wasn't thinking about winning the game by the end? He's got to have a strategy. If you don't have a strategy for the whole game, when you're up against the All Blacks or the Wallabies, you're going to lose, that's for sure. He can't just think about what's going on now. He has to think about what's going to go on 10 minutes from now. 20. If you're not thinking strategically, you shouldn't be a coach. Same thing. Teleocentric. Well, let's continue. We'll finish in a moment or so. That which is sharper is always orthodox. It is not heterodox. More about this, Lord willing, tomorrow. There's no new doctrine. Daniel tells us there's a clearer understanding in the last days of what's already been revealed, but there's no new doctrine or revelation. When you hear this as a new thing and a new teaching, this is not God. I don't want to delve too far into this because it relates too much to tomorrow's subject, but that which is sharper is always orthodox. It's not heterodox. Just a little bit more. In Scripture, that which is sharper is Judeo-inclusive. It is not replacement. Mark my words. Israel is a litmus test. There is nothing unique about Jews as individuals. They're people who need to get saved. There's nothing special about Jews making them different than Alpha Council or Zulu. But there's something very special about the God of the Jews, the Book of the Jews, and the Messiah of the Jews. If somebody is supersessionist, if somebody does not believe in the prophetic purposes of God for Israel and the Jews, neither do they understand the prophetic purposes of God for the church. It shows a litmus test. Being right about Israel does not automatically prove somebody's kosher on everything else. you've got some really over-the-top lunatics who are right about Israel, but they're out to lunch otherwise. You've got people in the extreme axis of the Messianic movement who are putting Gentiles under the law. I know Afrikaans people up in Wartham, in the Transvaal. These are Afrikaans adult males who are getting circumcised. Crazy. I've seen things you wouldn't believe. John Hagee, Jews don't have to be evangelized. It's a dual covenant theology. Being right about Israel does not prove people are right about anything else. Mark my words. If they're wrong about Israel, their other doctrine is flawed somewhere. I have never known a theologian, an author, a preacher, not even one, who was wrong about Israel, who was not screwed up in their other doctrine. There's a reason you've got people like John Piper, going out now with Rick Warren, pushing Rick Warren's agenda. We have to unite with Islam and Hindus and Buddhists to bring in global peace. This is Piper, replacement theology. John Stott, we can't teach this an eternal hell. He's an annihilationist before he died. Replacement theology. I guarantee if somebody is wrong about Israel, they're wrong in their other doctrine. They are fundamentally misreading Scripture. I've never seen a single exception. Linguistic priority. That which is sharper has a proto-linguistic priority. That which is sharper has a retro linguistic priority. Look with me, please, in conclusion. The book of Nehemiah, chapter 8, verse 8. Nehemiah 8, 8. This is a big one, unfortunately. I wish it wasn't. What it is. Something found only once in God's Word. It's something God addresses once and did not see any need to address it any more than once. It's the only verse in Scripture that speaks to the issue of translation. They read from the book, that is the Megillah Torah, from the law of God, translating to give the sense so they understood the reading. After the Babylonian captivity, only some elderly people and the Levitical priests knew Hebrew. They spoke now Chaldee, a similar but different language that people could no longer read the scriptures. Ezra, a scribe, translated, explaining the meaning, giving the sense, the Hebrew sense. There are essentially three main approaches to translation. Literal, dynamic equivalence, and paraphrase. Paraphrase is the least desirable. It can only be justified as a temporary provision in certain circumstances. One, if they're well done in children's Bibles, when little kids are learning to read, and you're trying to get them saved, and they're 6 and 7, and they can only read, okay. If it's well done, as a temporary provision that they can read properly, I'm not against it. Also, you had certain missiological situations of missionaries in Equatorial Africa some decades ago, people were far from Mount Kilimanjaro. They didn't know what snow was, had no idea. So the missionaries translated, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow, they translated it coconut, because they knew what coconut was. Until they could show people pictures of snow. Okay, I can handle that as a temporary provision. But there should be no other reason to read a paraphrase, to read the living Bible. Or if you want a mitzvah, you have a copy of Eugene Peterson's the message. Put a match to it, please. I compared what he wrote in John 1 to the Greek text of John 1. It's unbelievable. A Jehovah's Witness would not have the audacity to pull stuff like that. And that's Rick Warren's Bible of choice, by the way, the message. The Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word. The Logos became Sardis and tabernacled, Catastano among us. What it's saying is God would become a man. And the same as he dwelt and the Shekinah dwelt in the Old Testament tabernacle, he would now tabernacle among us. That's John 1:14 in Greek. That's what it means. The Word became flesh and moved into our neighborhood. It has no resemblance to the actual meaning of put a match to the stupid thing. Burn it. God will bless you if you put it in a furnace. Paraphrases. Now it gets complicated between the literal and the dynamic equivalent. How literal do you want it? There's a very literal translation in English, at least I can't speak about Afrikaans, called Young's Literal. It's so literal you can't make sense of it because the syntax in Greek is different than in English. But it's very literal. But you couldn't read it, let alone preach from it. There's been a noble attempt to produce a study Bible that is pretty good for what it is, called the Amplified. It brings out all the possible nuances of the original languages if you don't know Greek and Hebrew. But again, it's something you can't preach from or witness from it. How literal do you want it? It's not that easy as people make out. Then we have dynamic equivalence to translate the original idea. Well, when you do that, the problem becomes it can veer towards interpretation instead of translation. It's the interpreter's opinions. Oh, we don't want the dynamic, we don't like the New International Version. Well, I don't particularly like it either, being honest with you. I don't think it's very good. But when the New Testament and the original Greek quotes the old, 80% of the time, it's following the Septuagint, which is a dynamic equivalence. It's not literal. It's not as simple as people make it out to be. What can we conclude? Only one verse speaks of this issue. The priority is on the original meaning of the original text, the original autograph, in the original language. It is proto-linguistic. It is not retro-linguistic. I have no problem with the King James. God has used it. I respect the history of men like Coverdale and those who produced it. I really do. But let no one tell you there's not mistakes in it. There are. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, 1 Corinthians all tell us Jesus was crucified not on Good Friday. He did not raise on Easter Sunday. He rose on Yom Rishon of Chag Matzot, the Hebrew feast of first fruit, the first day of the week of unleavened bread. King James says it's Easter. Easter. That comes from Ashtaroth. The Holy Spirit is not in it. I had a King James only guy from the States, and he was very, I met him in England, and he was very disturbed. And I said, well, let's read this. And I read from the Psalms. If I forget the old Jerusalem, and my right hand forget its cunning. And I read it in Hebrew. What do you say that says, may my right hand forget its cunning? That's not it. There's no such thing in the original Hebrew. Jehovah Yahweh will bring salvation with his right hand. That's a figure and metaphor for Christ. If God can forget his covenantal and prophetic promises to Jerusalem, he can forget his own son. That's what it's actually saying and meaning in the original language. Oh no, my right hand forget it. You've got these Ruckmanites They actually say that editions found in the 1611 King James edition of the Bible, not found in the original, are further revelation. The canon of Scripture closes by warning about adding. Now again, I'm not against the King James. It's wonderful for its prose. I've got three copies of it. But the priority is on the original meaning of the original languages, nothing else. And when you talk to King James only people, invariably, very, very few of them, very few, can read Greek and Hebrew themselves. Can I possibly tell you? I can't speak Afrikaans or Dutch. How can I give an opinion about the accuracy of an Afrikaans Bible when I can't read it? It's absurd. I can read Greek, I can read Hebrew, I can read English, but I can't read Afrikaans. It's absurd for me to try it. This is absurd. It's absurd. This is not to attack the King James or to attack people who read it. But King James onlyism, Romanism, is idiotic with a capital I. One verse speaks of the issue of translation. God only saw fit to put it one time in his word. Proto-linguistic priority, not retro-linguistic priority. A translation does not have priority over the originals. So it is. The sharp and the sharp. Sharp. And sharp. The holy kiss. The holy kiss requires two lips. Grace and truth. You can't kiss your wife or your husband for Valentine's Day when you go home tonight with one lip. It won't work. I guarantee you, try it 100 times, it's not going to work. 1,000 times, it's not going to work. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. You need two lips. Two lips. Let's read it again, we'll close. Grace and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace kissed each other. Chesed, Mishamayim, Mishkaf. Amet, and Aaretz, Kismoch. Chesed, the Amet, Mishkaf. My dear brethren in Jesus, let us always greet one another with a holy kiss. God bless and thank you for joining us. See you tomorrow.